I have to thank everybody for very patiently waiting. I know we're running very behind schedule. I'd like to thank our speakers as well. When we put together this session, just to give it a bit of context, not that depression is something new when, you know, we're talking to young people, but it was just after IIT Madras was shaken by the suicide of Fatima Latif. And it was an extremely disturbing time. Students all over the place were questioning the motives behind the suicide, and depression took a backseat, I suppose, in all of the conversations that went about. So we decided to start the conversation again, because we have predominantly a very, very young crowd, as I'm sure you've seen, and a lot of them would probably be wondering, can I talk about what I'm going through? Because I think everybody at some point of time, I don't know if they will confess to it, but I'm sure they've been depressed. And I'm sure you've seen a host of this in all of your experience across your fields. So I'm just going to quickly jump into it. I'm going to ask Saras Bhaskar to tell us what she thinks India's students are most unhappy about and why they're getting there.
Thanks, Daniel. Well, pursuit of happiness, it sounds cliche. If we ask the youngsters what they consider as happiness, you know, we may hear them saying, no academic pressure. No pressure whatsoever from parents.
Is this the doctor or engineer kind of pressure, or?
Any academic pursuit. Okay. Maybe even playing football, being in a band, car racing, cricket, or having 6 lakh followers in their Instagram. Probably many more activities which I am oblivious considering my gray hair.
All of our gray hair, actually, if you want to count. So.
Alternatively, some others may say academic excellence, high-paying job, being the best always, and developing high self-expectations. Both are two ends of a spectrum, Daniel. Now, what has happiness got to do with depression? I see happiness and depression as two separate entities. I'll explain. Let me ask this question to the students. Do you want to be happy or anti-happy? Hello?
Happy. How many people want to be happy? Actually happy. Like not Big Boss happy, actual happy. Okay, great.
Lovely. Because being happy involves planning, prioritizing, organizing, and some self-discipline. Now just think about it. You desire to become a car race driver. Don't you need all the above to reach the desired goal? Aha. Now I'm mentioning all big words, isn't it? But the truth is, it is easy to develop anti-happiness when one does not have a vision, plan, and self-discipline. As a psychologist, I see that anti-happiness and depression are related. Now, what is depression? It is a state of helplessness and hopelessness. It can be due to genetic predisposition or environmental factors. However, both can be combated if recognized and given appropriate intervention. In my practice, I often see youngsters in depression coming for consultations. If they are self-referrals, my job is easy. But if they are brought in, I have to put overtime. Based on my experience, depression among Indian students, I have classified into 5 factors. Please listen to me carefully. Parents and peer influences. The second one is academic pressure and career path. And third one, as Mr. Pandirajan mentioned, identity conflicts. The fourth one is, most important, self-imposed grandiosity. I will talk about it. The fifth one is love relationship.
I'm just curious because I'm going to ask
just
this
mentioning
a little later.
About love relationship. That's the age, I guess. Yeah.
I said I was going to touch upon that a little later, but you know, now that you've brought it up, what percentage of the people that you see, especially in the age group that you're seeing in front of you, are sort of who come in for therapy after breakups?
You know what? What was interesting about 15 years ago when I was addressing the college students about falling in and out of love and getting dumping or getting dumped, how to overcome it. It was to the third year college students, but as time went by, I started addressing the first year students. And then when I started addressing the first year students, they say, ma'am, please go talk to my 10th standard brother who is talking about committed relationship.
Where were you when I was in college?
And what I don't understand is committed relationship is not about wearing the clothes that your boyfriend or girlfriend loves you to, or sending 200 emojis of loves and kisses in one day. It is about all the three big stuff that I talked about. Planning, prioritizing, organizing.
I think you just took all the fun out of a relationship.
Now, what I say is, we all play several roles in our life. Do you agree, students? So you're all students. Besides being student, what other role do you play? Of course, girlfriend, boyfriend, that's there. Because it's now become a mandatory. Absolutely. Give her a big round of applause. Absolutely. A brother or sister, a daughter or son. Friend, absolutely. Absolutely. If you are able to balance, juggle all those roles, Daniel, then you are ready to rock. The depression won't hit you.
I'm trying, but I'm sure my wife will tell you differently.
However, what I suggest is if you're able to balance those roles and put them in order of priority, capacity and competency, then please fall in love as much as you want, as long as you want, as many people as you want.
Or get Tinder.
However, remember, when it comes to making choice in prioritizing, it is not about the instant gratification. Please listen to me carefully. It is not about the instant gratification. It must be considering the long-term consequences of the current choices that you make. So once you comprehend this formula, the juggling act, believe me, the depression will run away from you. So what is it that you're getting from this statement here? Students? Balancing act. Balancing act, juggling the different roles that you take on in your life. Anything else, Daniel?
Thank you. I think we'll cycle back to that. I just felt like I was back in class again. It's been many years. But to quickly move on from that, I'm going to ask Dr. ES Krishnamoorthy. Dr. ESK is a neuropsychiatrist. He's somebody who's very well known in Chennai. I'm going to ask him for his take on going beyond the relationships and what depression does to your brain and whether there's actually a way out.
So we've got some slides, hopefully they'll come up. Doctors have one advantage over politicians. We can use slides to marshal arguments. And I'm actually going to talk about the pursuit of happiness, not about depression itself. A famous man once said, you have a million neurons in your brain, millions of them in fact, and they work very well, except when you start to stand up to give a speech. So, you know, we do have a brain that's composed of a million neurons. I'm trying to see if we can get this up on stage. But while we are on the subject, the million neurons are like your hardware. Yeah, it's there, but it's not at the back. So the million neurons are like your hardware, and these million neurons work in synchrony. They are constantly like a symphony, like a good orchestra working for you. The brain is the hardware. the neurons are the hardware. What they bring out, that's your mind, the connections between them, the chemicals that make them talk to each other, that's your mind. And that's the software. So your mind is like the iOS or like your Windows operating system. The brain is the actual computer. Now you then ask yourself, the next one please. In terms of temperament, Time asks this question. Are you going to be savvy Obama or honest Abe? And the point they were trying to make was that personalities are quite different, and even great presidents can be very, very different in the way that they come across to other people. And your temperament, your personality, is also hardwired in your brain. It's partly how you're born, it's partly your experiences growing up, what forms what we call your psyche. Your psyche is a product of your life experience. Next one. And then, of course, there's something called brain dominance. Your left brain is your logical brain. It's organized. It plans. It gives you the 3 points that Saras just gave you. Your right brain is your emotive brain. Oh, she's looking hot. That's your emotive brain. Both need to work in tandem. We all have a little bit of a left and a little bit of a right, but we are all also left dominant or right dominant. And that's going to some extent determine your happiness too. She's looking hot, but I can't afford coffee here, is a definite spoiler. Next one. And then, of course, we all have, if you put a line through your ears, you have something called your limbic system. That's what you share with the rat. That is where your emotions are generated. That is why a good meal excites a rat in the same way that it excites you. However, those then get projected to the front of your brain, the red areas. And those are pathways that are chemical rich, dopamine and serotonin pathways. Your happiness is actually linked with your being able to generate enough dopamine and in order for you to feel rewarded. So what makes you happy is an activity that makes you feel rewarded. And if you want to feel happy with your education, you need to feel rewarded. If you want to be happy in your relationship, you need to feel rewarded. It's reward that leads to happiness. And it's reward that leads to more dopamine being, released. Next one, please. And this is just to illustrate, the red is the dopamine, but there's also other chemicals like serotonin and norepinephrine. Please remember, we become depressed because there's not enough serotonin available in our brain. And all this is extremely dynamic, which is why it's not just about your mind, it's not just about experience, it's not just about feeling, it's also about how your chemicals are getting represented in your brain. Next slide, please. And then there is something called the genetic theory of happiness. And this is very important for you to remember. You have a small umbrella, a micro umbrella, that's related to the impact and the investment you make in your micro environment, your family, your school, the few friends that you have. Then there is a macro umbrella. The macro umbrella is what you do for your community. And I want to make this very, very important statement to you to understand as an audience, that the macro umbrella is stimulated not through material rewards. The macro umbrella is stimulated by altruism, by what you can do for other people without expecting a reward. That is what stimulates your macro umbrella.
So does that mean that we're all hardwired to feel happy when that happens?
We're all hardwired to feel happy when we are contributing to our communities.
So why is the world such a lousy place?
The world is not such a lousy place. It's how we see it. So in a sense, therefore, the happiest people are those who stimulate both their micro and their macro umbrellas. And if you think about it, where does your happiness come from? What taught you to be happy as a human being? It's those interactions you've had in your environment right from the time that you were a child. And those interactions are hardwired inside you. interactions that make you feel emotion, interactions that make you feel love, interactions that make you feel passion, interactions that make you want to do something over and over again because they are rewarding, those are the things that you should pursue in your pursuit of happiness.
Thank you. I think that was extremely, I initially thought it was going to be very heavy on theory, but I actually got the fastest insight into how my brain works. Thank you very much. Dr. Vijay Nagaswami is a very, very accomplished author and a psychiatrist with a very, very thriving practice here in Chennai. But I sometimes wonder if by classifying you as a relationship expert, they're shortchanging you.
They're shortchanging relationships.
So I'm going to very pointed thing, because taking the conversation forward, considering you deal so much with relationships, what are some of the most common misconceptions about relationships and their impact on happiness that you have seen so far?
I'm going to confine my comments to young people, okay? Not to, later relationships, which are bad enough, but, teenage relationships and young adult relationships are very hard. First thing, couple of things we need to understand. One, life isn't fair. Number two, relationships suck. But we need relationships. We can't do without them. And as Saras was saying, we need to learn how to balance. See, very often, when we think of relationships, we only think of the intimate relationship. But actually, we have a whole range of relationships which we are negotiating. First is our relationship with ourselves. Who are we? What are we? What do we want? What is our sexuality? Do I prefer being non-binary? Do I want to be heteronormative? Do I have other leanings which I'm afraid of, I'm not willing to share? Then you have your relationship with your parents, which at the best of times can be hard. And during teenage, it's absolutely out of the window. Because you are from two different planets, talking two different languages, and learning each other's language just doesn't happen until you have your own kids and you have to start the process all over again. The third thing is relationship with peers. This is where the largest pressure is felt. You are with a group, you want to belong, because the need to belong is something which is inherent in the human mind. And when we find that our peers are not too good with us, we start feeling alone, isolated, and then we start having a negative view of ourselves, of the world around us, of the future, and that's how we all sink into a depression. And then, of course, there's the intimate relationship. Now, parents are terrified that their children are going to get into intimate relationships. What I try and tell them is, look, they need a training ground. They need some space in which they can test things out, which they can learn from. They'll still screw up their marriages, that's a different issue. But at least they know that they're not going to make the same mistakes that they did when they were teenagers and young adults. Relationships are vital. Our understanding of our sexuality is vital. Because if we don't, we are never going to be able to get it right. And this is the only time we can. However, there's this wretched academic pressure, this pressure of exams which is hovering over us. And I think it's a combination of all of these that ends up in depression. Peer pressure, academic pressure, not being sure where one wants to go, and, your loved object doesn't seem to want to give you the time of day. So as a result, we start feeling low and depressed. And I think what is most vital, what we really need to learn, are life skills and relationship skills, which nobody teaches us. You're expected to, you're thrown into the deep end in a relationship, and then you just don't know what to do. you make mistakes. Sometimes you learn. Very often you don't. You make the same mistake again. And you get into serial relationships. But the thing is, if somebody was able to give us some help in navigating these things, all we need is a roadmap. We don't need pedagogy to tell us how to conduct the relationships. We need life skills training, which in my opinion should be, you know, part of the curriculum from school into college. You know, appointing a counselor is one thing, it's one good step. But we also need to know how to negotiate with ourselves, how to understand the world around us in a non-judgmental, non-confrontational kind of way. So if we could incorporate these in the curriculum, I think we would have taken a major step forward. And the next time ThinkEDU comes around, hopefully mental health will not be 20 minutes, but a much larger space than that. Because I think that if mental health is not adequately addressed, you know, the whole educational system collapses. Because if you're depressed, you're not going to get anything out of that system, however sensitive or however good that system is. People need to know how to identify depression in themselves, in their peers, in their friends, how to help them, you know, reach out and take help, and how to tell them that, you know, if you're depressed, it's okay. There is help available. You know, you're not looking down the barrel of a gun. You can get better. There are many therapies available today.
I think that's a very, very powerful message. If you're depressed, it's okay. You can always reach out. You can get help. But you know, just a very quick concluder to the point about the curriculum you made. I don't know what the curriculum is like in school these days, but when I was studying, there was one subject called moral science.
Hey, moral science is about do this, don't do that, okay?
And there was another one called value education.
Yeah, but they don't teach you how to
ask the lessons. The less I said about both of them, the better. That's all I wanted to say. We have just time for one question before we have to wrap up. One question. Somebody young at the back. Yes, please. The girl in blue, I think. Are you wearing blue? I'm so sorry. Okay. Can somebody just rush a mic to her? Very quick, 20-second question. That's all we've got time for.
Thank you so much, all of you. I really enjoyed this session. The first question that I have is...
The only question.
Oh, it's divided into two.
Okay, so we'll do the multiplication later, but 20 seconds, please. We've got very little time.
As a teacher, how am I to help my students who are depressed? What is the first thing I should do apart from sending them to counselors which they don't want to?
Okay, so why don't each of you just give me a 1 minute answer to that and we'll, you know... In no particular order, really.
Yeah, this is a good question because I was going to touch upon the teachers too. I don't want to hold only the parents responsible for any academic pressure or career choices pursued. I also find teachers putting a lot of stress on the students, egging them because they have been performing well or their siblings have been performing well in the same school, because I am a victim of such a condition. I was the black sheep of the family, I'm still am. Had a tough time where my mother went to the same school and it was very difficult for me to conduct myself. So what I'm saying is, when teachers put stress on the students, anxiety goes up and performance comes down, and that is the law of nature. So teachers, please do not transfer your anxiety to students. Have realistic expectations. Please do not compare. Please do not pull out the child who is not doing well in academics in front of the peers. Encouragement, empowerment will yield better results than condescending statements.
Fantastic.
That's all
Dr.
I can
Nagaswami?
Say.
I'm sure that poor teacher who asked the question...
She must be regretting it now.
You know, but in response to what you were saying, if you think a student is depressed, what do you do? You know? I think it's important that, A, first you need to know whether it's really depressed or whether the child is just a little stressed. If there is a depression, then I think it's important to get the family into the picture, because it needs to be dealt with in almost a community space. Everybody needs to help the child, you know, seek help. Sometimes it could be medical psychiatric help. They might need meds. They might need, you know, only counseling or CBT or, you know, one of the therapies available. However, we shouldn't just give up because a child says, I don't want to see a counselor. I think we need to keep at it.
Dr. Krishnamoorthy, with the last one.
Yeah, I think first, the teacher who is able to think about the child's mental health, please give yourself a big hand.
Please.
I think it's very important to be sensitive to it. Second, I think one reason a lot of young people get worried about talking about these things is because we deal with it rather insensitively. People like to maintain their confidence, and young people are as entitled to their confidence as anyone else. So before we go and talk about their mental health to their parents or to anyone else, we really need to talk to the young person first a little bit to understand. One thing a teacher can do is take the conversation out of the classroom to a slightly more neutral space. And I think people open up better when we talk with them in neutral spaces. And so, you know, a conversation when you're walking in the ground or over a cup of coffee is far more likely to yield results. And I think the third, I know that it's difficult to go see a professional, but the first thing I would encourage anyone who's stressed out to do is to go see a professional, for the simple reason that's your safe space. Everything you say there is confidential, and that person doesn't come at you with any prejudices. They come at you with a completely open mind, or at least I would hope that they would. And so it's very, very important, therefore, that we do encourage people to see professionals, and increasingly schools and colleges do have counselors, which is a very, very good thing.
I think it's a step in the right direction. Thank you very much. You guys have been a fantastic panel. I sincerely hope that one day, all the other questions, please feel free. All of our panelists are here for a little while. Please do address it to them offline. I do hope we reach the stage where people can say that they're depressed. They can go to their teacher and not be afraid of their friends calling them mental. It's a word I've always hated. And on that note, I hope that day comes soon. Thank you very much.